Birds flying high, you know how I feel. Sun in the sky, you know how I feel. Breeze drifting on by, you know how I feel. It's a new dawn, it's a new day. It's a new life for me, yeah. It's a new dawn, it's a new day. New life.
Perfect.
So we're finally there. So this is, as I already described, this is going to walk you through the process of creating a sculpture. There's the birth of a sculpture. And it's in connection with the show at the Northwind Art Center. So now you know what the building looks like when you get there. And so that's the Northwind Art Center. And this is the tree from which the sculpture was created. So the tree split spontaneously, which enabled the owners to obligate them to cut it down. And since I was friends with them, you know these people, Mike and Donna Monroe, the tree came from their yard. So I bought 1.5 of that tree. So there they are.
Yeah.
So the inspiration was Nina Simone. So I love Nina's songs, and she's been a favorite for a long time. Unfortunately, I never ever got to see her when she was alive, and she was kind of the darling of the civil rights movement, the leaders, the Black leaders in that, and was in close association with all of those leaders. So at any rate, the next thing I had to do is I had to find photographs. And I went online and I just grabbed all these photographs that I used to refer to once I decided I was going to do that. And then I also had tools. I think, let me go back a couple of times. I think there should be a it's not there. Okay, we're gonna photographs. So then I had tools. Here's a couple of my tools. Let's go back one. There's the majority of this sculpture I carved with old-fashioned sculptor's mallet and chisels. And there are an array of chisels that you can see. But I also have a giant belt sander, and it normally has a flat level bed that allows you to sort of set a board on it and slide it against it. But the way I use it the way it is here. Because I need to be able to move the piece in all sorts of things, sometimes big pieces. And then here's an example of an early work that I did, 1971. And that was from also a piece of black walnut wood, but it was a small log, and it had a big giant split in it. So you can see that. And so what I did is I left the split be, and I carved it as though it was a veil surrounding the figure. And there's the guy that carved it. And then this piece on the right, La Femme, is in the exhibition. It's the oldest piece in the exhibition. I had to borrow it back from the purchaser who lives in Billings, Montana. And I refurbished it for her too as well. So here, the next big item was the log. So after we got the tree, we got the log. And there's the log. And the log, of course, is from that split tree, so the other side of it is flat. And actually, the flat side is the side from which we view the log today. So when we see the Nina Simone, her face would have been almost right where this, where you see that sort of loop shape in the grain, just below the orange mark. So that's the top end of the sculpture. Here we see the log in early stages of construction. This is a chainsaw stage, do what you call roughing out. And here's another version of the roughing out. Now you can see that the projection that's on the right there is really where the head and face are carved out of that part. And then I have one of her arms is upheld. And so that sloping plane is going to be one of the arms. And then here we see the process going on. I'm carving that projection. And we see an early hint of the beginnings of the head and face. And here's more step-by-step development of that form. So initially I had to carve everything very large, and then just trim it down. So I recarved the face probably 6 or 7 times before I really got even close to the final one. Here's more carving. So now this sequence is actually opposite. The laying down is the earliest one of these three images, but it does show the profile. And then we see two steps, but there is a comparison of the photograph with the laying down figure. So it gives you an idea. So looking at the edge of the form is more important than looking at the middle of the form when you're trying to do a 3D portrait or sculpture. So you want to know what's the profile, and then you keep moving around and get different angles of what the profile is. You can see that I marked a little bit on there with magic markers. You can see an ear that's not yet carved and things like that. So that's what we have going on there. And in a way, I kind of like the way that profile looks. And I could have stopped there and thought it was a beautiful sculpture, but I didn't. So here's a little more development of that. So quite a bit more developed in there. So I probably carved the face at least one more time after this particular step. There's no hint yet of the arm, but you do see the hint of the rib cage starting to come, and the neck and rib cage. And then now we'll see more views of just more steps. The arms are starting to come into place here. So the log is big. The log probably weighed close to 1,000 pounds when I started. So it's not just real easy to stand up. So I had to carve almost the entire figure while the figure was laying down. And so here's some more of that. And as we see early stages of drawing, you can see the chainsaw there clearly. And then one of the things, as I'm carving, now we're getting close to the more finished stage, but the wood gets cracks in it, or what we call checks, you know. And that happens just because the log is, even though it had been drying out for about 3 years when I started it, as I carved it, dried out even more. And as it dries, it shrinks, and some of these cracks open up in it, and then they have to be repaired. So I use that big belt sander to make, out of some of the scraps from the piece, I make wedges. And I sand them into wedges, and then I put glue on them, and I put glue in the cracks, and I drive them in, and I fill the wood, not with wood filler, but with actual wood wedges. And that makes a much better way, because I've found that wood fillings over time, they open back up, you know. So then after that, now we see the figure laying down, and we see the figure laying down. So it's laying against, I have a 4x4 on a stump that kind of gets it up, so it's at a carving height. And the keyboard needed to be made wider, so I had to go and buy a board of black walnut material and glue it on to the keyboard. And we're showing that process here at this stage. And then here's another view of another step of building the keyboard. And also you can see the development of the eyebrows, see the hand, development of the hands there. So you can see where I'm building up the lighter colored wood is the wood I'm gluing on. And it has to be clamped and glued as I go. And that there will be yet another piece that has to be glued onto it before I'm done. But I had the hand is carved out of all of the same of the original piece of log. So there's no, but the fingers are very delicate. So for a long time, I kept them just as like flippers because they're fragile. And as you're working, it's easy to break and off, and then you have to glue pieces back on and so on. And so that was one of the major things. And also notice, as I say here, the eyes and eyebrows. So here, this, we're getting to the finished enough stage. And so I decided I did not want to paint on it in any sense at all. So instead, I ordered a stick of ebony, which is a much blacker wood yet than black walnut. And then I cut that up into little tiny, that little stick cost $75, just one little piece. It was about 30 inches long and about an inch and a quarter square, the cross section of it. And, So I drilled a hole for each one of the two irises, and then I made a plug, and much like a wedge, I drove it into the holes, and then carved the surface of that plug down. But for the eyebrows themselves, I cut them very thin and was able to carve and blend them and glue them in place. So that's how they're formed. The black keys of the keyboard, which we see in this picture, are also ebony. So after I got all of the width of the keyboard, I covered it with a veneer of birch. So I bought a roll of birch veneer that's very thin, and I put a veneer on it for the white. And then I took a marker and I marked all of the white keys with the lines on them. And then I put I cut the ebony up into all these little slivers that become the black keys. And I really had to think pretty carefully because my instinct was to make sure I put the black keys at the correct edge of the keyboard. It would have been a kind of a drastic mistake if I had got them the other way around and so on. But again, lots and lots of clamping and so on to get everything in place. And because it's a curved piece, it's very hard to, like this long, right down the middle of the keyboard there, you see a longer, narrower step. It's clamped on each end. Just being able to figure out a way to get the clamps to clamp because it's a curved, complex surface was right. So, and then here we see the sculpture in a nearly complete stage with the detail of the hand as well. And you can see into my studio, other things in the background, and you can see how good of a housekeeper I am, all those sorts of things. So now we can see what I'm talking about, the upraised hand. I had her put her hand way over her shoulder and her fingers stick out in kind of a starburst and almost like she's dancing. Then the little white beads that you see are actually cowrie shells. And I don't know how many of you are familiar with cowrie shells, but cowrie shells are a type of seashell, a snail-like creature that occur in tropical waters all around the world. And people, very early cultures and in undeveloped parts of the world before westernization, they used cowrie shells for money. And so they're a very special kind of shell that has resonance around the world. So they did that in coastal Africa. They did that in New Guinea. They did that in many places, coastal North and South America. So they're, and I happened upon them as I was helping my mother garden in Custer, South Dakota. So somebody had collected them and they buried them, and I'm helping her spade up and I find all these cowrie shells. So I recognized them, sifted them, and thought I would save them for some future purpose, you know, and that was 20 years ago. And I finally found a purpose. And then here's a series of pictures of the sculpture itself. You'll notice that the keyboard is curving and it has a kind of unusual perspective. So the keys are kind of in perspective. The further down you go, the more angled they get. And that's to kind of give a little emphasis of the dynamic of the music. Here's a close-up of the finished face. So when I was doing this, I had the problem of how do I deal with the whites of the eyes and the white of the teeth. And so I toyed with the idea of trying to put birch veneer in there, but that's a curving surface and it just, I messed with it and I couldn't make it work. So instead, I simply left the natural color of the wood untreated. So when I finished this, I finished it with what's called Watco oil. That's a penetrating finish. And the wood gets darker as you oil it. And so the difference, the wood has darkened a lot from what you saw while I was carving on it. And the eyes and the teeth have no finish on it, so they appear lighter. And that's kind of how I solved that problem. The photograph I was using was printed off, from one that I saved from that I found online, and it was blurry in places. And but you could see she had in the headgear that she had all these dangling ornaments, and so I didn't understand what they were. So I made these little birch, using some of that same birch, I made these little birch pendants all over the place. And after I got it all done, Ellen looked at it and she says, well, those are pearls. So in her real headdress, those were strings of little loops of pearls. But in my sculpture, they're what you see. There you can see the curvature of the keyboard much easier than the other views. We already see this. Is this thing repeating this? Yeah. Okay, there's the detail of the hand again. Keyboard. And there's the Northwind Art Center again. So we can take questions now if people have questions.
Okay, thank you, Alan. Yeah, you can unmute yourselves to ask questions and see how that.
I want to do one. Can you hear me?
Yes.
This is still. So I think that tapering and the curving of the keyboard is absolutely fantastic. I think the whole thing is really, really interesting. But I think that some of your, I would not have known how much thought and precision went into it without your pointing these things out. So thank you very much.
Yeah.
You're welcome.
Yeah. Alan, yes. How did you affix the cowrie shells like along her hem, and how were they on the wood?
Well, that's a pretty good question, because I had to figure that out, you know. And so what I actually had to do is, every place there's a cowrie shell. The cowrie shell, you know, it's kind of like a marble almost, but it's an oblong marble. And they're actually a little bit more pointed on the backside, the part that's in there. So I drilled a hole about a half inch in diameter and about a quarter inch deep every place that I wanted a cowrie shell. And then I took a chisel and I enlarged that hole a little bit so that it was more oblong. And then I basically used construction adhesive, like liquid nails, that type of adhesive, and put that in the hole and push the cowrie shell into the construction adhesive, and that glues them in place. And so that's how I did that.
Wow. Thank you.
Yeah.
How many hours did you put have in that, Alan? Approximately. Well, if you keep count.
what I can tell you is that I started in September and I finished in April. And
that's pretty fast, I would say.
Yeah.
So
in April.
So that's about 7 months. That I worked on it, and I worked on it nearly every day. Not all of every day. Sometimes I'd work a couple of hours, but sometimes I would work 6 or 7 hours. So I never kept a tally. I'm not that disciplined of a bookkeeper. but it took a long time, you know. It really did take a long time. And there's lots goes into it, you know. Any other questions?
Yeah. Yes, you were talking about
finish.
Michael,
when you found the split in the wood, you said that you filled them with wedges that you made. Do you ever use some of the sawdust that you get mixed with glue, and what do you think of that as a filling?
Well, I have used that technique. My experience is that when I carve these out of a whole log, you know, so that they're not a board, they're not even a block of wood made up of a stack of boards, and which is a way some artists who do wood carving do. And there is some advantages to that. One of them is that the wood can be dried more evenly, it can shrink more evenly. So what really causes the cracks is uneven rates of shrinkage in different portions of the wood. So some wood shrinks more than others, and so there's internal tensions that are generated inside the log that cause it to split. So if you go to log houses, you very rarely will see a log that has no split, because as they dry, they split. And they just do that automatically. And some woods are more prone to that than others. But at any rate, I find that if I put a filler in, the dynamic of the log and the changing humidity conditions will eventually squeeze that filling back out, and it won't stay in place. And I find that, and some of that, as I'm doing this, sometimes I'll fill a crack. And you know, like I said, I worked on this for 7 months, you know, and a crack that I filled will open up wider, and I have to put another wedge right next to the first one in order to fill it, and so on. But if I keep doing that, by the time I'm done, usually no new cracks will appear. Because I glue the wedges in place, they don't move, they don't squeeze out. They stay in place. And so it just works better. Besides that, some of the cracks get pretty wide. They might be a quarter of an inch wide sometimes. And by filling them with wood wedges, you continue to have the surface and the texture of the wood grain. And it is sometimes a challenge to get when the wood isn't finished yet, you're not really sure how much it's going to be affected by the finish. So some pieces that I thought were exactly matched in color will turn out that either the wedge will be darker than the surrounding wood, or the surrounding wood will be darker than the wedge. And so there's a little color variation. So when you're looking at the actual sculpture, you can see some of those things. But at any rate, so yes, I've used that, but I find this other is ultimately more effective.
Alan, you use primarily black walnut.
Well, it's my favorite wood, but in the show I have several other things. There's in the exhibit itself up in Port Townsend. There's one that's in Madrona. It's actually a root of a Madrona tree, and that wood has an extreme tendency to chip. So in that sculpture that's up there, that's the Madrona, I had to put hundreds. I estimate I had to put at least 1,000 wedges in the piece as I worked on it. Hmm. And so I would say there's probably over 100 wedges in Nina, but nothing like the number that was in that Madrona piece that's in the show up there. And so that's the comment, I guess. Any other questions?
Yes, I wanted to make sure that's the uncarved tree trunk at the bottom of her skirt, right?
It is.
Yes, it's just so perfect. It's so perfect.
Let me go back a few.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah, I love that.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I went forward. Let me. I didn't go backward. We'll go there next. But let's go here. So now down at the lower left corner, you can see that's the edge of the log, and that's the edge of the original log. And so when I got it all curved and stood it up, I wasn't able to stand it up most of the time while I was working on it. In order to have it stand level, it had to be tilted. And I didn't want to cut off any of the bottom of that log. So instead, I had to create a system of little posts that it stands up on. So those and so I did an extension in order to make it stand the way it does. Let me see if we can go back a couple more. It doesn't show in this photograph. It's been eliminated by that.
Yeah.
But the back edge of it, that corner that you see that's the right lower corner that sticks out, that's a good 6 inches from the floor when it stands up. And it has all these little stilts that it stands on that are progressively sized to exactly how much tilt it needed. And then they're attached to the bottom of the wood. And that was a problem. It's another complicated problem. You know, it was very complicated angles that had to be cut to get each of those stilts to fit securely in place and attach them and make them strong, because they have to be strong. That's the heaviest end of the sculpture. And when it's being moved, a lot of times you have to hold on to it and be able to lift it even by some of those stilts. And that's a factor. Let's see if we go back a little further. Well, let's see. I think that's now here. You see right down the side of her face, you can see one of those big check marks that's been filled. And that one's not very visible, but there's within this view, there's 5 or 6 other places that there are fillings that you can't see that blend in well enough that they're very hard to see unless you're really up close and know they're there. You can see there's some checks, some splits right down the back of the hand, and several others. So, and then one of the things I was concerned about is that the fingers which are free and separate, not get broken. And so I came up with an idea. So I took and I drilled a long drill hole down the length of each finger. And then I took about a 9-penny finishing nail that was about 3 or 3.5 inches long. And I drove it down the hole. And then I counterset it, and then I plugged the hole so that there's a steel rebar in effect down each finger.
Wow. And the little finger is bent, but you still manage to somehow do that with the little finger too.
Huh. Yeah, it doesn't go down the full length. It just goes from the knuckle down. But it's raised up, so it's the most vulnerable one of all. Or one of the most vulnerable, except for perhaps the, let's see here, scroll. Yeah, those fingers, each one have the same thing happening behind her head. So they're very vulnerable too.
And the keyboard, the white and the black, is all the natural wood. Nothing was painted. It's just the natural color of the wood.
The only place there's anything that you could call painted, and I used a black magic marker to do it, is the linings around her. I didn't think I could do a good job trying to cut and glue those pieces in place. So I decided I did stain those with a magic marker. And I guess the lines between the keys and the white keys are also basically magic marker.
Wow.
Ellen, how tall is she and what does she weigh?
I don't know how much she weighs, but more than you.
Thanks.
The log weighed 1,000 pounds.
So at any rate, she's 6.5 feet tall.
Wow.
Wow.
So her toe that you see sticking out there is a piece that I had to add on. I was concerned that I had to give her stability, that she wouldn't walk over. So she needed a toe, an extra little platform area. So that was an extension that I made that is then lag bolted in place, so that it's very strong back underneath there.
So Alan, I have the feeling that part of the fun is figuring all this out, right?
There's a lot of figuring it out. Yeah. Doesn't figure out, you know, practical things. You don't want your sculpture to fall over and break somebody's neck.
You know. But it makes you feel good that when you figure something out, I bet.
Right.
Proud.
In fact, another thing I did to make her head, I tried to think of ways to make the sculpture be lighter, you know. So I ran a borehole that's about 1.5 inches or 1.75 inches in diameter down the top of her hat, her headdress, and down into towards the center of her head. And then there she has a little cap on top that closes that off. And that cap is also made from the ebony, the place I used that. I don't know if we can see that in any of the photographs or not. Let's go forward and see what we get. Just barely see it at the top of this picture. You see a little black line there? That's the ebony. And you can see it again there, but not there. Over there. So, as I mentioned, and many of you already knew, I did a catalog for the whole show. And every so there's an introductory essay in there by Joseph Bednarik. That's an introduction to the show, which I think is just fabulous, and it's fun to read. And I'm proud that he had such good things to say. And then there's an essay by me that's about imagination. And then there's commentary about every piece of sculpture that tells something about the background of that sculpture, what the idea was, or some peculiar, something about it. I never tell everything about anything, but I tell something about everything, if that makes sense, and leave the rest for you guys to interpret in there. So if you don't have one already, this is available online on Amazon or Barnes & Noble, or it's available at Collective Visions Gallery, or it's available, Collective Visions Gallery doesn't have very many copies because I took them all up to Northwind, so they're up there. So it's only, I've reduced the price. Originally I had it priced at 20, but I decided that I'd rather people have it. And so I have it priced at 10, which is the cost, is how much it costs me to make one book, not with zero profit. So that's a cost basis thing. And, I hope that you're curious enough to read it.
Wow. I have got to leave. I loved this. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you. I'm glad you were participating.
Bye.
Bye.
Alan, thank you very much. I enjoyed the exhibit in person. I enjoyed the catalog, and I very much enjoyed your presentation. Thank you very much for all of the above.
Thank you. Thank you. And thank you to the committee for choosing to feature me. And, I'm sure that when I do make the presentation on Wednesday, it will be different. It'll be, in part, it'll be a dialogue between me and the other artist, and she will have a PowerPoint as well. And her work is also fabulous. I would say you're welcome to sign on to that. And what I would suggest is send me an email for the link, and that way I'll make sure you get it. So I'll just send you, I'll just respond with a little announcement that it has a link. You have to register in advance for that talk. So there's a registration link in that email. And there's also, I guess I put it up on Facebook this morning too. So you can, if you find it on Facebook, you can register via Facebook.
Okay. Wow. Yeah. Well, this was very, wow. Well, thank you, Alan. Boy, I'm just curious, where did you learn all this? Did you have a mentor, or did you learn this in college, or how did you?
Well, there's a, if in the catalog, there's a little blurb that talks about the artist. And my background is that my grandfather and my father and my family had a small log sawmill in Custer, South Dakota. And so I can't remember when I didn't draw, and I can't remember when I didn't have wood, to endless supplies of wood to build things out of, and actually access at a very early age with adult-sized tools, including some power tools. I can remember working alone with a table saw when I was in fourth or fifth grade.
See, so it's just a part of who you are from an early age. Wow.
And even another irony is that my best friend, who lived across the street from me, his father also ran a small sawmill, and mostly what we did is we built things all the time. We were always building things. So that was, I guess, we like to say, have sawdust in our blood.
A story he told me was,
when they were little kids, 8, 7, 8, they would go and watch carpenters build houses in town. And so they, when they built their forts and their playhouses, their studs were always at 16-inch centers, because you know, they knew how to do stuff because they watched.
That's true. We always used to, we mostly used hand saws for doing that. We didn't have a skill saw. I don't think either of our parents had one when we were that age. But we always used a square and drew a line and sawed on the wood.
I want to really recommend the book there. I mean, just different people have different approaches to art, but to me, it just really opened all kinds of more doors. I'd already seen some of Alan's work, but it just, Joseph Bernardnik and just explanations. I'm more kind of a verbal person than visual sometimes, and it got me so excited that I had to run down there and look at the Nanina's through the window of the exhibit down there in Bremerton. But yeah, I think it's amazing. And the sculpture itself is eternally fascinating, but the book helped access it.
And I got a new insight into our relationship this morning. I had no idea that you did 1,000 canvas to checks on that Madrona stump. So I cannot imagine anyone having that much patience. But so that explains how come you put up with me all these years. I'm a very patient person.
Thank you. This is a fascinating and beautiful pieces. And are there any other questions for now, or is just everything is? There's actually 12 different pieces, right? Is Simone is just one of them?
Well, I think there's 18 pieces.
Oh, okay.
In the catalog, but that includes the back cover, which is a welded steel, 12-foot-tall welded steel sculpture that. Is now on the campus of Sioux Falls, University of Sioux Falls, in front of the Science Center there, commissioned to do. And then it includes one other piece that is not in that they chose not to display. So when I took all the sculptures up, then the curator of the show up there has godly authority, and he decided that we had too many pieces, and he pulled one out. And it's the one that's in the book that's kind of orangish red, close to the end. That one is not on display at his discretion. But other than that, everything in the book. So there's I guess that means there's 16 pieces of sculpture. I think is the right count. I don't know. Anyway, 16 or 17 are actually on display.
Okay, thank you.
And it's not the biggest one.
Okay.
Yeah, and they're all in the catalog, and not all of them are 6 feet tall. Some of them are you could carry around.
There's some that are tabletop size.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I think the North Winds opens at 12 noon, I believe, from noon to.
They are open on Sunday.
Oh, they're open on Sundays too. Okay. Yeah.
So I think it's Thursday through Sunday that they're open, those same hours.
Okay. Good. Any other?
It's Northwind Arts, and I think it's .org. If you Google them. They changed their name between the time I published the catalog and the show actually went up. So it used to be called the North Winds Art Center, and now it's just called Northwind Art. Okay. The website has a slightly different name. So if you go to the website and it says North Winds Art Center, that's the outdated one. You need to go, it just says Northwind Art. That should come up first anyway.
Okay. Any other questions from our comments or this is okay.
Thank you, Alan.
Thank you, Alan.
I've got to go now.
Beautiful.
Thank you to all of you. I hope this wasn't too long. And
no.
Delay. I don't understand why it happened, but it did.
Oh, yeah. Almost. It's almost predictable. Something like that's going to happen. So thank you all. Thank you all for being with us. And Alan, thank you so much for showing us your art. Incredible. I didn't realize there was so much to it. Of course, I should have known that, but it's amazing. So
well, thank you to all of you for being interested. And thank you especially to all of the people on the Adult RE Committee.
Okay.
Birds flying high, you know how I feel. Sun in the sky, you know how I feel. Breeze drifting on by, you know how I feel. It's a new dawn, it's a new day. It's a new life for me, yeah. It's a new dawn, it's a new day. It's a new life for me.